managed globally, and governments needed to work together to try and address this problem. In 2005, we see the Kyoto Protocol being agreed, and leading nations here agreed to try and reduce their overall emissions by as much as 8% between 2008 and 2012. Notably, that didn't include the US at that time. In 2010, we see G8 committing to the first constraining and restrictions around reducing the impact of climate change and trying to retain overall climate increase to less than 2 degrees against pre-industrial levels, with an aspiration of keeping it as low as 1.5 degrees. In 2015, that was broadened to the whole of the UNFCCC group. More recently, we see the US leaving the Paris Agreement in 2020 under Trump and rejoining in 21 under Biden. And I think we've had a number of conversations over the last 2 days about COP26. Obviously, it's underway at the moment. Some of the targets going into COP26 were really to try and effectively ensure that there was $100 billion of investment for developing companies on an annual basis to help them become more sustainable, and equally well to agree the global net zero target of 2050 across the whole group. We're already hearing some things coming out of COP26, and I think many of us are hoping for some significant change. One big thing is 85 of the leading nations have already committed to significant targets as regards reforestation, which I think will make a lot of impact. If we look at things from a global perspective, and this really is just showing some of the facts and really giving some life to the sorts of things that we're seeing happening. Across the globe, there have been many events. So in March 20, in Australia, wildfires, leading to 33 deaths and 3,000 homes burned. Many others here are not stopping them all. In August 20, California, wildfires causing 100,000 evacuations. Winter storms in Texas, leading to 3.5 million homes without power. And lastly, Haiti, 30 deaths and 200,000 evacuations as a result of flooding. And equally well, we see that recently Reuters reported one of the UN agencies indicating that the number of disasters associated with floods, wildfires, heat waves, etc., has increased fivefold over the last 50 years, causing in the region of 2 million deaths and 3.6 trillion worth of total losses. But what does that mean from a regulatory perspective? Obviously, as we see the governments focusing more on reacting to environmental change, they're clearly driving the agenda of the various regulators. There's been a lot of focus within the EU, that's the light green areas, introducing regulatory change. We see France and Germany equally well bringing down specific regulations. Likewise, UK and Canada also. And more specific, more recently with the US, as a result of rejoining the Paris Accord, we see the US beginning their journey. Just picking on a few of these key ones, in 2019, Germany introduced their Climate Action Programme 2030, where they were looking for a 55% reduction in their overall emissions by 2030, and net zero by 2050. This was significantly strengthened more recently, whereby now their target is a 65% reduction and net zero by 2045, which is more in keeping with the 1.5 degree aspiration. In 21, you see the EBA introducing stress tests encompassing more than 50 banks. So this is a start of the requirements in terms of exactly what banks need to do to support regulators, additional work that they have to undertake. And this was testing specific circumstances for significant climate change. In June 21, the Bank of England had its first comprehensive tests including climate change, stressing 19 of the largest banks and insurers within the country. In 22, we see the EU introducing its taxonomy, which will require enhanced data gathering as part of the broader transparency and reporting capabilities. And the UK are also introducing the green taxonomy, which will help set the bar on environmental sustainability investments to try and prevent greenwashing. As we can see, regulations are coming thick and fast, and our expectation is as time moves on, this will just exacerbate. In terms of industries, many industries are impacted, and clearly banks invest in many of these. Just looking at the S&P global ratings, we see it's not just the ones we expect, oil, gas, power generation, etc. We also see refining, metals and mining, chemicals, transport, building materials. All of these industries are impacted to a certain degree, and it's clear that significant investment will be required to enable organizations in these areas to move away from their current high levels of emission. Obviously, the response organizations within these sectors take will be watched very closely by banks. Banks will understand their plans, and they will work with them to determine whether to invest or not, and understand how to factor them into their future planning. But it's not just climate that banks need to focus on. We've spoken a lot over the last couple of days about ESG and why they're together, and focus on environment is more significant, but equally well we have the social and governance aspects. Some of the topics that banks are looking more significantly at. Example, in Germany we have a board member quota paper, which requires any organization with four board members or more to have at least one woman board member, and any government-owned or government-controlled firm with three board members or more to have at least one female board member. The EU has proposed regulation on gender pay equality, with the intention here that requiring greater transparency. Any organization that has unreasonable pay gaps is required to work with workers to try and mitigate these gaps and remediate the situation. In the UK, we have the UK Stewardship Code 2020. This is focusing, setting high standards for organizations involved in investing money. And the intention here is that governance structures need to be explained, and if they don't reflect diversity and inclusion, then the reason why they don't needs to be further explained. And equally well, in the US, we have the US NASDAQ final rules, which has recently been approved. And this is requiring listed companies to disclose aggregated statistical information around boards' self-identified gender, around racial characteristics, and around the LGBTQT+, get that right, makeup of the organizations. And equally well, there's a requirement to have a certain number of diverse directors. But how is all this impacting banks? From our perspective, we've kind of categorized it as an ecosystem. We have a number of change agents out there, so governments, regulators, clients, shareholders, and organizations such as the UN's Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change. Each of these are having impacts and influences in terms of the banks and how they need to respond and react to ESG-related activities. And from a bank perspective, this makes it a significant priority for the board. Many boards are creating ESG governance committees at a very senior level and working very closely with them to understand how they need to manage things going forward. And internally, this impacts a number of areas. It has a significant impact on business strategy. We've seen that. Many organizations are looking at their own internal ESG approach, their consumption of energy, their consumption of water, their diversity inclusion makeup, etc. has a significant impact in terms of risk management, risk appetite, risk approach, etc., with significant requirements in terms of transparency and reporting. And equally well, banks need to be clear in terms of marketing and communication to let the external world know what they're planning to do, to ensure that they're on the front foot as regards ESG, and people understand how they're involved and how they're planning to move forward. In terms of external influencers, we clearly have the ESG ratings agencies. We'll talk a little bit about a number of them, but there are many more springing up. We have the media commentary, and we have the very powerful social media, which is having significant impacts. And in terms of what this means, banks are looking at the locations that they operate within, and the locations their clients operate within, the industry sectors, whether they should invest or not, based on client planning, etc., and the products that they currently support and supply. So I'd just like to, let's say, explain a couple of terms which we've heard a little bit about over the last 2 days, and some people are very familiar with this, some people are less familiar, but many external commentators talk about two key risk categories within ESG. They talk about transition risks and physical risks. From a transition perspective, it's all about how we move from where we are now to be in the net zero world that we anticipate being in decades to come. So as we know, there will be changes in regulation, there is changes in climate and energy policies and financial regulations, there is change in consumer demand and sentiment, and move towards low carbon generating goods and services, and a greater prevalence in terms of investing in ESG friendly businesses and products. From a physical risk perspective, this is focused more on acute weather and significant changes in climate. We've seen manifestations of this in terms of wildfires, in terms of floods, in terms of increasing sea level. So these risk types have a wide range of ramifications, impacts including potential business disruption, physical damage, impacts on costs and pricing, and larger challenges such as macro or socio-economic implications. Consequently, from a risk perspective, this impacts credit risk, market risk, strategic risk, operational risk, and of course, reputational risk. Just like to return a little bit to the IPCC organization. On an annual basis, the IPCC generates a report, and this is publicized and circulated quite widely and has a significant influence. In this year's report, it was quite gloomy, and I'd just like to reflect on a couple of the key highlights coming out of that. So temperature rises are not occurring uniformly across the globe, so different regions are being impacted in different ways. Significant impacts such as the reduction in permafrost in Siberia is actually weakening the globe's capability in terms of defending against the price, the climate rise impacts. The 1.5 degree target doesn't look achievable as we are currently, and in terms of best estimates, the expectation is without significant change, it'll be 2100 before we get there. An increase in frequent weather events is strongly attributable to climate change. I don't think there's a surprise there. And sea levels are rising three times faster than they have been doing in the last decade. And I think one key thing I'd like to point out is 125,000 years ago, when the temperature was at the region that we're projecting, so 1.5, 2 degrees higher than it is currently, sea levels were 5 to 10 meters higher than they currently are, which clearly will have significant impacts. Reports such as this by such esteemed bodies will clearly have an impact on government approach and subsequently on regulations, and equally well an impact on the way banks need to manage themselves in this market. Just looking a little bit about one of the other influencer categories, so shareholders, if we look at shareholders. There was a recent ISS shareholder study across S&P 500 countries. And there's a big shift that we see from focusing on transparency to more focusing on governance. And in 2017, roughly 15% of resolutions were focused on governance. In 2021, this has increased to 40%, so more people, more shareholders are pushing actively for change. BlackRock, in 2020, identified 244 companies that they didn't think had an appropriate approach to ESG. Now, for 53 of those companies, they voted board member changes, and for the remaining 190 or so, they indicated that if they didn't see significant progress within a 12-month period, they could expect similar activities. I think many of us are aware of influencers such as Bill Gates and their opinion. Bill Gates thinks that we're not moving quick enough. We need more cooperation, more standardization in frameworks, and we need to be moving much quicker. And finally, in terms of, let's call it smaller scale investors, BNP Paribas undertook a study in terms of investor sentiment. And for people, they found that in 2017, 48% of their investors were looking to invest more than 25% into ESG-related products. And by 2019, that had already increased to 75%. Just looking a bit at ESG ratings agencies. So this is a relatively new area, and as we've heard from some of the commentary earlier on, it's not specifically regulated. Ratings agencies are looking to derive statistics across environment, social, and governance, and there's not a lot of similarity across those, so deriving a single rating for an organization across those three areas is clearly challenging. We have organizations, let's say, such as MTSI, Sustainalytics, and ISS, just to name three. And here we share a little bit about the sort of difference of focus that each of these organizations has across each of those specific areas. Our take on this is banks will not be able to manage by taking information from a single ESG rating provider. I don't think there's a surprise there. We expect the model to be very similar to that which is adopted for credit rating agencies, where banks typically take in multiple suppliers. They create an aggregated view based on systems and algorithms, and then usually provide the capability internally to override where they believe they have more pertinent or up-to-date information. Just looking a little bit at influencers and how they work. Just picked a few examples here, looking across different categories. So we see Waterfair, who advertise themselves as the first video on-demand platform dedicated to the future of the planet. Now they're focusing on the UN's 17 sustainable goals, and provide videos around that, supported by people such as Prince Harry. And this is targeted really at the so-called TikTok generation. And I guess we've probably all heard in the news that the younger generation are, let's say, significantly impacted by everything that they hear regarding environment and the impending problems, etc. So their voices will definitely be heard in the future. We have Elon Musk with his XPRIZE organization, who has promised a 100 million prize to be shared across companies coming up with technology innovations that can substantially reduce carbon emissions in future years. And we have climate activist groups such as Extinction Rebellion and Rainforest Action Group, who effectively protest or create media coverage for organizations such as Bank of England, Barclays, HSBC, where they see inappropriate behavior from an ESG perspective, or they don't think that their approach to fossil fuel is appropriate for the current situation. It's clear that these are a small number of influences, but there's many out there, and clearly banks need to take note. We see social media as a potential blind spot. Many banks aren't as advanced as leading online retailers in terms of understanding customer sentiment from a social media perspective. Standard models exist around tooling, around data management, and around expected outcomes, focused on improved risk management, enhanced revenue, etc. If an ESG blind spot is to be avoided, banks will need to enhance their monitoring, including ESG-related factors around their own organization, around their clients, and around their clients' supply chain, and factor that into the way that they manage their business, their strategy, and their dealings. So what are banks doing? Many banks, as we've seen, are taking have it setting ESG as a significant priority. Lots of them have joined the Task Force on Climate-Related Financial Disclosure, which is focused on improved governance, improved disclosure around strategy, risk management, metrics, and targets regarding ESG. The Net Zero Banking Alliance, where members commit to lending investment portfolios aligning with the Net Zero 2050 agenda, and members of that organization need to commit to targets for 2030 and 2050 within 18 months of joining. The UN Principle for Responsible Investment, where organizations commit to factoring ESG analysis into any investment decision, ensuring that organizations they invest in have appropriate ESG disclosure. Many banks are also limiting investment in organizations that derive significant revenue from fossil fuels as early as 2025, with leaders such as JP Morgan and ING with limits of 5% as the maximum, or in the case of JP Morgan, zero investment. As regards governance, banks are significantly committing to a more diverse workforce, with targets for women in leadership as high as 40% for Citi and Santander, and other changes such as introducing chief sustainability officers, ensuring a holistic approach to ESG becoming more popular. In terms of specific initiatives, we see organizations such as Citi, JP Morgan, Santander committing to reducing their credit exposure to coal mining by 100%, with other banks such as ING and Barclays committing to no longer financing companies that derive more than 5 or 10% respectively of their revenues from coal by 2025. We also see UBS, ING and Credit Suisse committing to reducing their own greenhouse gas emissions by between 75 and 100% over the next 10 years. I think it's interesting to note that that was a question that came out of one of the earlier sessions today as regards banks focusing on their own internal response. I think here we see that that's definitely part of the focus. And as regards the non-environmental side of things, Santander have a significant focus on diversity and inclusion, targeting between 40 and 60% board members to be women, and targeting equality of pay by 2025. I think it's interesting to note that the banks are coming up with many of these commitments, and it's going to be very challenging for them to track their own performance against those commitments. Obviously, that's something that the external world will be tracking and will be watching. So part of a bank's response to ESG is to fully understand its commitments, track its progress against those, and make sure they communicate widely on that. So where does that leave us from a risk perspective? I think from our point of view, the big biggest risk is no action. This is not just as a result of climate change itself, but equally well, the regulatory change anticipated, customer and market perception, all of these can have significant impacts on revenue, compliance, and reputation. We believe an overarching governance model will be required. This will enable organizations to adjust business strategy, align from a risk perspective, and ensure that they are managing these priorities appropriately and aligning all their activities with careful orchestration. ESG factors will doubtless have an impact on pricing. Some organizations will be able to leverage new opportunities, such as new products or technology, increasing their share prices or their creditworthiness. Others will be impacted negatively by climate change in particular regions or customer perception, leading to business or revenue challenges. Banks with a clear understanding of the drivers for change and appropriately adjusted risk appetite will be able to leverage new market opportunities in an efficient manner. As we move closer to the deadline, pressure to adjust will, of course, intensify. Organizations that do not closely monitor external events and track progress, both internally and externally, will struggle. Internal goals will need to be adjusted on a frequent basis, and we believe this is going to be an iterative process. Underpinning all of this will be a focus on data. Organizations will need a broader set of data. They'll need to look at different data suppliers. They'll need to look more carefully about how they get data from clients, client supply chains, and they'll need to track and manage that internally more efficiently. We see the best approach to this being a four-step approach. We focus first on governance. Organizations need to look at their governance model to ensure that they're aligning business strategy, risk management processes, regulatory response, etc. We see, as a result of changing the governance model, focusing more on the strategy, understanding which areas they want to invest, what's their approach to fossil fuels, what's their approach to various locations, sectors, or products. We anticipate an iterative approach being necessary. As regulations increase and become more stringent, as they understand how clients follow their plans, do they meet their plans, do they not, this will have implications in terms of banks' appetite to invest, and subsequently in terms of their own internal strategy. And finally, in order to navigate through this complicated maze, step four advocates provision of additional data on a large scale across a number of new axes, coupled with sophisticated analytics to enable organizations to manage the transition and ensure they remain on the front foot. From a government's perspective, we see many banks already making significant strides. Banks such as JP Morgan and HSBC already have overarching ESG governance functions. Other banks have not yet elevated ESG governance to this overarching level, but have them embedded within credit functions or other areas. We expect as the pace of change increases, it will be necessary to review this and potentially elevate ESG governance to the higher level. From a business strategy perspective, defining strategy starts with a clear understanding of the current situation, both internally and externally. Banks will need to understand government targets, and we see events such as COP26 materially changing those. That will have implications on regulations. Banks will also need to understand clients, client plans, and strategies. We see boards in conjunction with their ESG leadership team defining the bank's approach to ESG. This will include adjustments in approach to location, to sectors, and to products. And we see banks setting high-level targets and making external commitments, signposting to shareholders and external commentators their direction of travel. These milestones will need to be tracked internally and externally as we move towards the net zero target. We've seen outcomes such as this as introducing business limits, adjustment of risk appetite and risk management approach, commitments to ESG-related targets, and a revised focus on potential opportunities or moving away from certain industries or sectors. Managing through the transition. We see this as step three. Tracking requirements is going to be key. Understanding the external world and the changes. Collecting data, as we mentioned, from multiple sources, some of them new, ratings agencies, climate-related data, news, social media. Monitoring and analytics to understand at a fine level changes that might cause concern or give rise to alerts or changes in approach. More focus on transparency and reporting, both from a regulatory perspective, but also to market, to customers. Marketing information, broader communication. And then reviewing strategy as we go around the cycle. Each of these changes could have implications on strategy, which need to be tracked as we go forward. From a data perspective, we focused a little bit on this, but we see four core components here. Obviously, we have core banking data in terms of portfolios, locations, products, services, etc. This will need to be coupled with limits from a regulatory perspective or own commitments. Additionally, we see a necessity to ingest broader streams of data, ESG ratings, climate data, client strategy, client performance, also client supply chain, media data and social media data. And then analytics on the back end, providing transparency of reporting, supporting stress testing requirements, measuring and tracking against own KPIs. Clients will introduce KPIs and request bespoke reporting and alerting should unforeseen events arise. Banks will also set specific limits around specific clients based on their strategies, location based on climate change or otherwise, product limits, and client limits. In order to navigate through this complicated maze, the additional data on a large scale across a number of these new axes, coupled with sophisticated analytics, will be a key necessity. In actual fact, we see this really becoming very much a significant data problem, with sophisticated analytics supporting organisations in understanding how they manage through this maze of change as it escalates and increases in the coming years. So that concludes our talk on ESG. I hope you found that interesting and useful, and I hope there's some things that you can take away there to help you in your own ESG journeys going forward. And I'd now throw it open to questions from the floor.